Okay, ready?
Yes.
And you can see the PowerPoint?
Yes, I can see.
Okay. Now, let's go through two examples, which are very simple, but I think very instructive. One example is the power needs of a car to climb a hill. Now, we have a car, okay, and the mass of the car is 1200 kilogram, cruising steadily on a level road at 90 kilometers per hour. It is a 30 degree slope road. If the velocity of the car is to remain constant during climbing, what is the additional power that must be delivered by the engine? So what's happening here now? The car is going at a constant velocity. Okay. Obviously, we don't care about heat or other forms of energy. We care about mechanical energy here. And the velocity is constant. That means there is no change in kinetic energy. But it is climbing a hill. Therefore, there is a change in potential energy. Now, that means the engine will have to work harder to make up for that increase in the potential energy. And that is the additional power needed. Okay. Now, what is the change in potential energy? It is simply mg delta z, right? Delta potential energy change, mg delta z, the elevation change there. And what is the power needed? This potential energy change per unit time. So divide both sides by time. This becomes time rate, and that becomes, delta t divided by that. And what is delta z over delta t? This is the vertical velocity. Okay? How much the car is climbing per unit time? The vertical component of the velocity. Okay. Therefore, this is the power that I need. And if you substitute the values, the mass is 1200 kilogram, g 9.81, velocity is total, the actual velocity is 90, but the vertical component is simply multiplied by sinus 30, and some conversion factors. 1000 meters square per second square is 1 kilojoule per kilogram, and 1 meter per second is 3.6 kilometers per hour. Okay, because 1 kilometer per hour is simply plug in the values. It is like 1000 meters per 3600 second, and it will give you that conversion factor there. And if you do the calculation, you will get 147 kilowatt or 197 horsepower, almost 200 horsepower there. Okay. So as you can see, by simply calculating the potential energy change, actually the rate of potential energy change, okay, you determine the extra power your car needs to climb the hill without slowing down. Okay. But you remember in reality that this is, very high hill, 30 degrees. If your car tries to climb that hill, probably the velocity will drop. It will lose some velocity because the engine power will not be enough. And again, this is the reason. Because the potential energy of the car is increasing. That energy must be supplied, must come from somewhere. If, let's say, you don't increase the power, what will happen? The kinetic energy, will be converted to potential energy and the car will have to slow down. Okay. Now another example, again similar. Now this time the car is on a level road. Okay. That means no change in elevation. Okay. But this time it is accelerating. It is accelerating. The mass is 900 kilogram and it goes from 0 to 80 kilometers per hour in 20 seconds. Okay, which is not high. Now the question is, how much power does the car need? Okay, so here just to accelerate, that is the amount of power used to increase the velocity from 0 to 80, which is the same as the energy, the extra energy the car needs for the velocity to increase or kinetic energy to increase from 0 to 80 kilometer per hour velocity and the corresponding kinetic energy. And how is the solution this time? Again, same approach. Determine the change in the kinetic energy, okay, total, and then divide that by 20 seconds to get the amount per unit time, which will give you the power, right? Again, the change in kinetic energy, plug in the values, okay, with this conversion factor, again, 1 kilojoule per kilogram is 1000 square meter per second square. And you end up with 222 kilojoules, but this is not power. How do you get power? You must divide it by the amount of time interval, which is 20 seconds. Divide by 20 seconds, and you get 11 kilowatts here, which is about 15 horsepower. Okay. Notice that the mass of the car is always in the equations and the extra power and extra fuel needed is proportional to mass directly. And this explains why small cars are fuel efficient and large cars, cars with a lot of mass, they require a lot of fuel. Therefore, if you are buying a car and you want it to be fuel efficient, I think the first thing you will do is the size of the car. If you buy a small car, you can be sure that other things being equal, it will burn a little gasoline. But if you buy a large, heavy car, then it will burn a lot of gasoline. Why? Because we always, you know, accelerate and then apply the brakes, slow down, accelerate again, stop at the, you know, red lights, stop signs, and then accelerate. And what we do is we are wasting all this energy, okay, by applying the brakes when we stop or slow down, when there is a traffic. And each time the energy wasted, okay, is proportional to the mass of the car. Otherwise, if you were going at constant speed all the time, then it wouldn't really matter. Any questions on these two examples related to the car? No questions. Okay, now that means now we can deal with the first of all thermodynamics formula, which is the conservation of energy principle. Okay, now we discussed energy. And we discussed energy interactions, heat work, and also by mass. Now the question is, how can we put them together? How are they related to each other? How do they influence each other? Okay. And here the relation that relates all of them together is the first law relation or the conservation of energy principle. To give an example, let's say we have a rock here, mass M, okay? Let's say potential energy is 10 kilojoules. It is stationary, so kinetic energy is zero. Now we know that if you push this rock, okay, what will happen to its velocity and kinetic energy? From zero, it will just pick up speed, right? And the kinetic energy will increase. Now the first law says, if kinetic energy is increasing, one form of energy, another form of energy must be decreasing. So what is decreasing here? Elevation, delta z. Therefore, the potential energy will have to decrease. And if you disregard the air friction, okay, it will require some energy. Then, if the kinetic energy is 3, then potential energy must go down from 10 to 7. So that the total energy here is also 10. That is, energy is conserved. So when you do energy analysis, you have to be doing some energy accounting. If some energy is disappearing, it must reappear somewhere else in another form, okay? So this is the, I think, the importance of the first law. It is energy bookkeeping. It is just like if you are an accountant, okay? You have, you know, expenses, income, whatever. You have to balance them out, okay? So the amount of money you have, the amount of your income, and the amount of your expenses, they must check out. You use the conservation of money principle there, okay? Income minus expenses equals the change in the amount of money in the bank account, okay? In energy, again, energy entering minus energy leaving is the change in the amount of energy. So it will come to that there, okay? For example, if you have heat transfer to a potato from the hot air in the oven, and the hot air is losing 5 kilojoules of energy, it means now the change or the increase in the energy of the potato must also be 5. Again, conservation of energy, okay? Or if let's say you are cooking, for example, and you are transferring 15 kilojoules of heat to the pan, and you are losing 3 kilojoules of heat, okay, to the outside air, then the increase in the energy of the food inside, or the water, if you are boiling water, must be the difference 12. Okay. Why? Again, the conservation of energy. That is, if you measure, you will measure these values. Okay. But if you believe in the conservation of energy, that it is true, it is proven, which it is, then you can simply do calculations. But 200 years ago, these things weren't so clear, so they would have to measure everything there. If you consider electricity, for example, 5 kilojoules of electric energy, there's a resistance heater here, okay, is consumed here in this resistance heater. Then that energy now is in the form of heat or internal energy in the air here. And if it is adiabatic, meaning there is no heat loss, okay, then the change in energy must be the work transferred inside, which is 5 kilojoules. Again, conservation of energy. If you measure it, you will see that, you know, this is the case. Or if you have a mixer, okay, and the mixer, let's say, consumes 8 kilojoules of, it can be electrical energy or mechanical energy, okay. You may have a motor here, and you can measure it. And then measure the temperature change of the whatever is here, water, air, whatever, okay? And calculate the energy change. Again, you will see that it is also 8 kilojoules. That is, in the absence of any heat transfer, then the amount of work transfer is equal to the energy change or the increase in the energy of the system. Or another way, you let's say compress a gas. Yeah, you know that the gas will get hotter. Let's say the compression work is like 10 kilojoules, okay? And then if you measure again the temperature rise here and do the calculations, you will see that the increase in the energy of the air here will be 10 kilojoules. That is, the boundary work done on an adiabatic system is equal to the increase in the energy of the system. Now, what if we have both? That is, we have, let's say, heat entering, heat leaving, and then work is done on the system altogether. Then what we do is, we determine what is entering, which is 6 kilojoules work, 15 kilojoules heat, max 21. What is leaving? 3 kilojoules of heat. What is the net? It is 18. So we say that the change in the energy of the system during this process is 18 kilojoules. Okay? Since heat and work interactions, the energies, they are addable. They can be added. So what we are doing is we are using this energy balance. Total energy entering the system minus total energy leaving the system and the change in the total energy of the system. Symbolically, energy in minus energy out is energy change. So all the observations, all the experiments, confirm this relation here. Therefore, we confidently say that energy is conserved, and this relation here is the relation for the conservation of energy, which is called the first law of thermodynamics. Okay? So the whole thing is based on experimentations and observations, and the result is very intuitive. Again, you know this from physics in high school or the physics courses that you may have taken before. Now let's study each term separately. What is this delta E system? What is this energy in? What is this energy out? Because this is the relation that we will use most often in this course. This is our the main equation, okay? So we have to understand it well. Energy in minus energy out is energy change or whatever we are studying. Okay, energy change. Now let's concentrate on this one, okay? Energy changes, we are analyzing process, is simply the energy at the final state of a system and minus the energy at the initial state, right? For example, the change in my bank account between yesterday and today. Yesterday, I had 100 liras. Today, I went to the bank, I had 80 liras. So what is the change? 20. So the change in the balance of my account is simply the amount today minus the amount yesterday. The final amount minus initial amount, whether it is money or energy. Okay? So delta E system is E final minus E initial. So we use the subscript 2N1, E2 minus E1. Okay? But keep in mind that total energy, we defined it as internal energy plus kinetic energy plus potential energy, right? Therefore, the delta E is also delta U plus delta kinetic energy plus delta potential energy. That is the changes in all these forms of energies there. Now, what is delta U, the change in internal energy? Mass times final internal energy minus initial internal energy. What is delta kinetic energy? Final velocity square, initial velocity square. How about the change in potential energy? Elevation change times mg. Okay. Now, special cases. If you have a stationary system, and when we say stationary system, we mean stationary system. Elevation remains the same, no change. Velocity remains the same, no change. It is either stationary or constant velocity. In that case, the change in potential energy is zero, and then the change in kinetic energy is zero, and the change in total energy is simply the change in internal energy. Okay. So this is, you know, what is involved when we deal with delta E system. We look at internal energy, kinetic energy, potential energy, and if the system is stationary, total energy change is simply the change in the internal energy. Okay. Now, mechanism of energy transfer. What is energy in and energy out? Okay. Now, delta E system, we just went through it. Changes in internal, kinetic, potential, etc. energies. But for simple compressible systems that we will deal with, we will not consider other forms of energy. Now, energy in. What are the mechanisms of energy transfer? We discussed it is heat, right? Heat transfer. It is work done by the system or on the system. Or if it is open or control, open system or control volume, mass may be entering the system. So mass transfer, okay? So it is energy in minus energy out by heat, work, and mass. Okay? We can express this in the rate form. Divide everything by delta T or take the derivative as delta T goes to zero, which you get dt. This becomes time rate. So E in dot over dot, E out over dot minus is dE system dt. Okay? You don't have the that symbolism there. So I wrote it as the rate of change of energy of the system with time. So rate of net energy transfer by heat, work, and mass is equal to rate of change of internal, kinetic, potential, etc. energies. Keep in mind that Q is Q dot delta T, W is W dot times delta T, and delta E is dE dt times delta T. If you know the per unit time values, multiply that by time interval and you get the total amount. Or on a unit mass basis, you can express it this way. Energy in per unit mass minus energy out per unit mass is energy change of the system per unit mass of the system. Or in the differential form like that. So these are the different forms of energy equation. And what you see here is, again, very important. This is the basic of the first law and the basis of thermodynamics, the most fundamental thing. Okay. Now, do you have any question on this? Any questions here? Are they clear? Basically, energy in minus energy out is energy change. No questions?
It's okay. Clear for me.
Okay, excellent. Okay, let's continue. Let's continue. A special case. If you have a cycle, that is, you have a process, you start from one, and then you go all the way and come back to one again. So two and one are the same, initial final states. In that case, since energy is a property, at this point, E1 and E2 are the same. Therefore, for cycles, what do we have? Energy in must be equal to energy out. Or net heat must be equal to net work. Let's say when we analyze car engines, steam power plants, whatever, this is what we use. Okay. So for cycles as a special case, this is what we have. And for energy in, energy out, we can also break it down, okay? Like Q in minus Q out plus work in minus work out plus energy mass in minus energy mass out, okay? Which is equal to delta energy system, okay? But keep in mind that for cycles, this is what we have, or the other relation. So if let's say you have a mass entering or leaving, you must consider energy transfer by mass flow. If there is work done on the system or by the system, you must consider the work transfer. And if there is a temperature difference, heat is entering or heat is leaving, then you must consider also heat transfer. But if it is, you know, perfectly insulated or adiabatic, it means no heat transfer, right? If you don't see any shaft, electrical wires crossing, a piston, you know, moving, it means there is no work transfer. And if you don't see any mass entering or leaving, it means no mass flow. Okay, so it simplifies the things there. Okay, let's do a simple example again from the book, so that we understand the concepts. Let's say we have a rigid tank. It contains a hot fluid. Okay, first of all, rigid tank means, okay, the size of the system is constant. It cannot expand, okay? And hot fluid we have. It is cooled, so we have heat leaving, as you see here, while being stirred, which means we have work input here. Initially, the internal energy of the fluid is 800, so initial energy we know. During the cooling process, the fluid loses 500 kilojoules of heat, so this is the heat loss. A pedal wheel does 100 kilojoules of work. The amount of work is given, it is entering obviously. And the question is, what is the final internal energy of the fluid? Okay. Now, is it clear to you how you will solve this problem? How can you solve this problem? Yes. Yeah, it is very clear, right? Again, energy balance, right? Energy in minus energy out is equal to energy change of the system. Okay, what kind of system is this? Is it stationary system? There is no indication otherwise, okay? Stationary system. So no change in kinetic energy, no change in potential energy. Then what is this delta U system? It is delta U, right? And what is energy in here? What is entering? This is actually work in, right? And what is leaving? There is no other work leaving. What is leaving? This is heat out. Okay. So what is the energy balance then? Work in minus heat out is equal to delta U. But what is delta U? It is U2 minus U1, right? So W in minus heat out is equal to U2 minus U1. Given, what is left? U2, right? And when you solve it, you get 400 kilojoules, okay? Any questions here, or crystal clear? But again, this crystal is the methodology that you need to keep in mind, okay? Just step by step, this is the basic relation, okay? Our basic relation, energy in minus energy of this delta A. And then just identify on the system what is entering, in what form, what is leaving, and what is changing. Any questions here? No questions. All right. Okay. Let's make it more complex, which is still easy. Let's say we have a fan, as you see here, and it consumes 20 watts of power when it is running, just 20 watts. Okay. And it discharges the air at a rate of 1 kilogram per second. And it is claimed that the average velocity is of the air 8 meters per second. Someone says, I have a, you know, excellent fan. It moves 1 kilogram per second, air accelerates it to 8 meters per second and consumes only 20 watts of power. And the question is this claim reasonable? In other words, does it satisfy the first order of thermodynamics? Can it Can we have such a fan? Okay. And normally, unless you know thermodynamics and do some analysis, you cannot answer this question. Okay, so here, what do we do? Now, again, we assume the inlet velocity to the fan is zero, which is reasonable. Okay, it is just pulling in the air from the room there. Okay, and accelerates to 8, the stationary air there. What we can do here is take this 20 watt and then determine the maximum velocity, that this fan can accelerate the air. Okay. So we take the fan as the system. Okay. And we just write the basic relation, since this is what given in the rate form, okay? I write the first law in the rate relation, energy in dot, energy out dot per unit time, and rate of change of energy. Now, this operation is steady. Look at the fan here. Does anything change with time here? Steady operation. No, it may change from point to point, but at any given point, nothing changes. Let's say the air here is always 8, and the air here is always at zero velocity. It is what we assume. And nothing else. So this is steady operation, continually operating the same way. Okay, nothing changes. Therefore, the energy content of the system doesn't change, which means this part is zero. Okay, this is zero. Then what do we have? If the change in energy is zero for the system, which is a control volume, okay, energy in is equal to energy out. Okay, look at the fan. What energy is entering here? Electrical energy, right? Electrical energy is entering. And we don't have any other form of energy. Air is here stationary. We choose the volume large enough, okay? So it is zero, elevation the same. Now, what else? Heat transfer is irrelevant. Okay, it is the same temperature all over the place. And energy leaving. What is leaving here? The some mass with some kinetic energy. So this is some mass with kinetic energy, which is this. So the first law says, or conservation of energy, the electrical energy consumed, okay, must be equal to this kinetic energy. Or what the fan does is converts the electrical energy to kinetic energy. Now, to get the largest velocity, we assume the operation is perfect. That is, all the electricity is converted to kinetic energy. In reality, it is probably, they are small, it's a small fan, probably no more than half. But we will check this claim, okay? And then what do? You solve for V out from here, in that formula, you get this relation, and plug in the values with the proper conversion factors, you get 6.3 meter per second. Now, what is this? This is the maximum velocity. Maximum velocity for the air leaving. That is, if the fan is perfect, okay, all the electricity is converted to kinetic energy, and it is 1 kilogram per second, the flow rate, mass flow rate, okay, the highest velocity you can get is 6.3 meter per second. What is the claim? The claim is 8 meters per second. So what is the conclusion? That claim is false. That is, the person is lying. Okay? Based on the first law of thermodynamics or the conservation of energy principle. Any questions here? Questions? Okay, let's do a different kind of problem. So once we have, you know, the relations, the components, now we can solve the real world problems. Okay, this is the beauty of engineering, and in this case, thermodynamics. Okay, remember we discussed this fan in our room, except that the room now is not insulated. Okay, it may lose heat to the outside through the walls. And in heat transfer, you will see that heat transfer is expressed like this. So let's just take this as given, okay? And this is called heat transfer coefficient U. The value, this is a reasonable value for our room, is given to be that. And the room area, heat transfer area, is given to be 30 square meters, that A, it is a heat the surface area. Now the question is, the room is initially at 25 degrees right here, and outside is also 25. Okay. Initially, and here the question is, what will happen as the fan runs? The room air will be heated, right? The temperature will go up. But as the temperature goes up, look at here, heat transfer also will go up. Because heat transfer is proportional to heat transfer rate delta T. Okay, see this relation? T inside minus T outside. So what will happen after a while? The temperature will rise so much that the amount of heat generated here, which is the conversion electricity here, will be equal to the amount of heat lost. And the temperature in the room will remain constant. So the question is, what is the indoor air temperature when steady operating conditions are established? Or you can say, what is the highest temperature this fan can heat this room? If initially outside is 25, inside is 25, same temperature. Or what is that delta T, okay? Between outside and inside. Okay, again, we take the room as the system. Again, energy rate form. Energy in minus energy of this energy change, rate of energy change. It says steady operating conditions established. That means the room temperature no longer changes, meaning the energy content no longer changes. Therefore, the change in the energy of system is zero when we have steady conditions established, which means energy entering must be equal to energy leaving. Now, what is energy entering? Electrical energy. What is energy leaving? Heat loss. Okay. Which is equal to heat transfer coefficient times area, which is 30 square meters, times delta T. The temperature difference between inside and outside. If outside is 25, okay, and Ti is the inside temperature when steady conditions are established, and solve for Ti, you get 26.1. So what is delta T here? 1.1 degrees, okay? That means if this fan, you know, runs there continuously, the room temperature will rise a little bit, 1.1 degree, okay? And then it will be steady. Because when the temperature is 1.1, the rate of heat transfer becomes 200. That is the electrical energy, which is converted to thermal energy, okay, equals to the heat loss from the room. So the temperature cannot rise anymore. Okay? Any questions?
So that means when the room arrives the 26.1, and then it won't go any further, right?
Exactly. Initially it is 25, you turn the fan on, the temperature will start rising, And when it reaches 26.1, it will just stay there. Because the heat generation inside, okay, as a result of electricity, because all the electricity consumed by the fan, okay, eventually is converted to internal thermal energy or heat, okay, which is leaving the room.
I got it.
Because of this relation, okay, they become equal. Okay, it is just like, you know, let's say you are filling water, a pool, okay, or a container, but there is a hole in the container, okay, and what happens is the water levels in the container rises. If let's say the incoming water rate is constant, the level will keep rising, the pressure will keep increasing, and the flow rate, which is exiting the pool, will be increasing. At some point, the incoming rate of flow will be equal to outgoing rate of flow, and the level of the water will remain constant. It is exactly the same thing, except here we have heat or energy instead of water. And finally, let's do this example. Again, very practical, okay. Now we have a classroom, okay. And here is the classroom, and we have fluorescent lights here, okay. And we have like 30 fluorescent lamps, each consuming 80 watts of electricity, and they are kept on for 12 hours a day, and the classroom is used for 250 days a year. The unit cost of electricity is 11 cents per kilowatt hour, and the question is, what is the cost of lighting of that classroom per year? Okay. Also discuss the effect of lighting on heating and air conditioning requirements. Okay, now we don't have any formulas for this, right? This is again just a logic problem, and we don't have energy transfers or whatever, so we don't need the first law here. So we will just use logic, right? What is given here? The amount of energy used per second. What is 80 watt? Okay. It is simply 80 joules per second. Okay. That is, we have like 80 joules per second of energy consumed. And we have 12 hours per day and 250 days a year. If you consume that much per second, how much will you consume in those many hours, days, whatever? So I think logically a multiplication process. So let's do it properly, step by step, okay? Now, lighting power. The power consumed per lamp is 80, right? 80 watts. How many lamps do we have? 30. So a total 2400 watt or 2.4 kilowatts. Now the problem can be like you have a 2.4 kilowatt heater there. What happens to the light inside? It is absorbed by the surfaces. It is converted to heat. Okay. So all the light is eventually turns to heat there. And this is the electrical energy consumed, 2.4 kilowatt. Okay, how many hours of operation do we have? 12 hours per day, 250 days a year. Again, you notice I write the units, right? And the days cancel, as you see. What do they have if you multiply? 3,000 hours per year. Okay. So for 3,000 a year hours, I continually consume 2.4 kilowatt of electric power. Okay. So what is the consumption? What does that 2.4 kilowatt mean? It means if I use this device for 1 hour, okay, it will consume 2.4 kilowatt hours of electricity. If I use it for, instead of 1 hour, 3,000 hours, then it will consume 7,200 kilowatt hours per year. Again, look at the unit, kilowatt hours per year, okay? So kilowatt hours, and what is this kilowatt hour? Simply kilowatt hour. So it's very easy. You don't need to, you know, to convert to the second and then complicate things. Because kilowatt hour is a respectable common unit. Besides, the unit of electricity, the unit cost, it is given in kilowatt hour anyway. Okay? Therefore, you get 7,200 kilowatt hour per year. What is the unit price per kilowatt hour? $0.11. Okay. So what is the total cost? $792 a year. Okay. Which is not a small amount, right? And these are reasonable values. A large classroom has, you know, 30 lamps, each consuming 80 watts, running, you know, 250 days for the entire day. It is like what? Almost $800 a year. And in winter, it will help you heat the room because all of it is converted to heat. But in summer, it will hurt air conditioning because the air conditioner must also remove that much energy, okay, from the room. Therefore, your air conditioning cost will go up, but your heating cost will go down. Okay. Any question on this example? Again, very logical, you know, step by step. And in practice, okay, you do this kind of calculations a lot. I think half of the calculations I do in my professional life, they are these kind of calculations. Very simple. So what you see here is what we do as engineers in real world. And unfortunately, many engineers cannot do this because they don't have the basic concepts there. But you will not be one of those. Now, you know, these are very easy, okay? And you will just do these calculations easily and confidently. Okay, any questions? No questions, so I will stop here. Next time we will have the quiz, and then we will continue with energy conversion efficiencies. I suggest that, you know, you study well, get the concepts clear, and the questions on the quiz will be things like this. The examples that we solved, okay? They will be very simple, but you will have to know what you are doing. Okay? So with that, I will see you next week. You all have a good evening and good week.
Thanks, sir. See you later.
Okay, bye-bye.